Welcome back, my dear students. Last class we have discussed on the introductory part of this prehistoric concrete. Now we will see some of the new topics which will be making your concept more clear on this prehistoric concrete. So till now we have discussed on the introductory part, which I will summarize it as the prehistoric concrete. I could tell it as the initial stress developed in concrete due to the prehistoricing force, which counterbalance the stress developed due to the external load, such that the overall depth in concrete is either in compression or a very small amount of tension is developed that can be easily taken by the concrete. The initial stress developed in concrete due to the prestressing force, that is, we will apply a prestressing force such that it will counterbalance the stress which is developed due to external loads, and the concrete will, or the member will always be in compression, or very small amount of tension is developed which can be easily taken by the concrete. The tension will be less than the flexural strength of the concrete, such that there won't be any crack formation or anything like that. The long span bridges, the highest can, some of this longest cantilever or spans which are very much larger, then one of the bridge here which is very, having larger span, then another bridge having larger span, which means we can conclude this as a prehistoric concrete is used for supporting larger spans. That is, when you require an unsupported length for a longer span, we'll go for this prehistoric concrete. That is like school auditorium. In supposing school auditorium or some theater, something like that, if you are placing a column in between your audience, what will happen? It will be an obstruction to the audience, such that we cannot place the column or beam in. It's not beam. We cannot place the column in between. So what happens here is we'll go for a larger span. In order to attain that larger span, if we are going for a normal RC structure, what is the disadvantage? There will be a larger depth for the structure. But if we are using this prestressed concrete, then there will be lesser depth. As a result, we can achieve larger span with this same prestressed concrete. Some of the other examples are shopping centers, then gymnasiums, parking garages, and all. If you are placing large number of columns, what happens is there will be obstruction in between, then cafeterias, theaters, etc. Okay, then you can see in some of the special structures where the length or the depth will be very much small, but we require high strength. Such structures also will go for prestressed concrete. You can see in this picture, see here, we require it will be a storage tank, so there should not be any crack developed there. For such structures also will go for this prestressed concrete. Now the two other new terms which you are going to study, that is pre-tensioning and post-tensioning. We have discussed this before also, but we will go in detail for this. First, we will discuss on pre-tensioning. The name itself says pre-tensioning, which means before the concreting, we are applying the tension, pre-tension. This pre mainly concentrates on the concreting time. So pre-tensioning means before concreting. So here I could say pre-tensioning means first you have the formwork being laid, the tendons will be placed like this, and sufficient pull will be given to the tendons. That is, it will be stretched to 70 to 80% of its ultimate strength. Do the concreting. That is, once after the tendons are pulled to its sufficient strength or sufficient prestressing required, now we will do the concreting and we will do the curing of the concrete. And when the concrete attains sufficient strength, we will simply cut it from here, such that the prestressing force, you can see here, the prestressing force will be imparted to this concrete by bond action. That is, due to the contact between this reinforcing steel or prestressing steel and this concrete, the compressive force will be imparted or will be transferred to this concrete, and as a result, this concrete will get compressed and this concrete will be a prestressed member. So you can see the tension is applied to the tendons before casting of the concrete. The pre-compression is transmitted from steel to concrete through bond over the transmission length near the ends. You can see here the railway sleepers, then electric poles, etc. Such examples for pre-tensioned concrete. So the various stages of pre-tensioning operation are summarized as the anchoring of the tendons against the end abutments. We will anchor it. We will place the jacks. We will apply the tension in the tendons to its required amount. We'll do the casting of the concrete. Then once the concrete attains its sufficient strength after curing and all, we'll cut the tendon, and as a result, what happens, the force will be transferred to the concrete. So these are the various stages of pre-tensioning operation. Okay, then the relative advantage of pre-tensioning. I'm telling the relative advantage because I am considering this with respect to the post-tensioning, which will come to know very quickly. But still, this is a relative advantage when compared to post-tensioning. That is, a pre-tensioning is suitable for precast members, which is produced in bulk amount. That is, if we want to produce similar kind of structures or similar kind of modules, then we can go for this pre-tensioning. In pre-tensioning, large anchorage device is not present. We do not require large anchorage device when compared to what? Compared to the post-tensioning. Because I had told you this is a relative advantage, okay? Now, the disadvantage of this pre-tensioning is there is a pre-tensioning bed is required for pre-tensioning operation. It will be costly and a lot of space will be required for this, and a good quality control and everything should be provided at this point. There is weight impeded in the pre-stressing bed before the concrete attains sufficient strength, because I told you once the concrete attains sufficient strength, only we'll go for cutting this tendon. So it requires a lot of time, and as a result, there will be a lot of period, waiting period required for this concrete to get strengthened. There should be good bond between the concrete and steel over the transmission length. If there is no good bond between the concrete and steel, what happens is the force will not get transferred to the concrete from the pre-stressing tendons or steel, and as a result, there won't be enough, we will not attain the sufficient strength that we require for this pre-stressed concrete. Now, the next term is post-tensioning. You can see here the term itself, post-tensioning, which means it will be after the concreting has been done. So the process is like this. We will have the concrete bed like this. At the time of casting of the concrete bed, what we do is we will keep a PVC pipe like this and we will do the casting. So if I am taking the side view, we can see a concrete, a small hole is being there like this, through which we will put the tendons. See, we will put the tendons like this. We will anchor it 1 inch and we will apply the sufficient pull or using some jacky or some hydraulic machines, different types of anchoring devices or pulling devices, will apply a sufficient pull. So you can see here the tendons are being laid through this, and sufficient pull will be provided through an arrangement from here. And once the sufficient pull is being done, we will anchor the other edge also, which means this material or this cable will be under sufficient tension. Now, once this is being anchored, what happens is there will be a small gap between this. Now we will fill this gap with grout, that is a slurry of cement and water. We will fill it and such that there will be proper bond action. So at the end, you can see like this, the duct is like this, the tendons are being, now we will fill it with grout. This is to be filled with grout. This is before filling with grout, we will fill it with grout. So the tension is applied to the tendons located in a duct after hardening of the concrete. The pre-compression is transmitted from steel to concrete by anchoring devices. So I hope you have understood this. This is being done for large structures where we cannot do it in a pre-stressing bed. So we, after installing this, we will do the pre-stressing. Means in the site mainly we will go for the post-tensioning of this structure. So the various stages of post-tensioning operation are summarized as the casting of the concrete with the duct being cast. We will keep the duct and we will do the casting of the concrete. The placement of the tendons, that is the tendons of the steel wires, will be placed. The placement of the anchorage block and the jack. Applying the tension to the tendons, that is one end will be anchored and from the other end the sufficient pull will be provided. Seating of the wedges. This you will come to know once you study the different process of pre-stressing or the different systems of pre-stressing. At that time you will come to know about the wedges. That is simply but After applying the in sufficient tension, we need to fix the we need to anchor both the ends. So we will provide this wedges. Now cutting the tendons. Once sufficient pull is being done, we will cut the tendons. And after this, the last step is we will fill the duct with grout for proper bond or for proper load to be transferred. Advantage of post tensioning is the post tensioning is suitable for heavy cast in place members. This is also a relative advantage when compared to pre-tensioning. Okay, the waiting period of the casting bed is less because we will not, once the concrete has attained enough strength only, we'll go for post-tensioning. So we'll continue the concreting, and once it has attained the strength, we'll go for post-tensioning and a single turn, or we can do it once the concrete gets hardened. The transfer of pre-stress is independent of the transmission length because we are anchoring from one end which is being anchored, and from the other end we are pulling. So it doesn't it or it is independent of the transmission length. This is because suppose you are having a pre-stress beam like this. There is a pre-stressing cable here. Okay, for a normal pre-stressed pre-tensioned cable, what happens is the maximum bond will be at the ends, and when it is coming towards the mid, it is getting decreased. It is getting decreased. The maximum will be at the ends, and when it is coming to the mid, it is getting decreased because the maximum pull will be at the ends, and when it comes to the mid, it decreases. But in case of a post tension member, we are having the post tensioning beam like this. We are anchoring it at one end. We are pulling it from the other end, which means this is getting transferred. There is no contact between these two. There is no contact between this is inside a duct. So whatever force we are applying here, that will be the final force. There will not be any loss due to this bond of between the concrete and steel. So it is independent of the transmission length. Now we will summarize the advantages of the pre-stressed concrete based on your understanding till now. The pre-stressing of the concrete has several advantages as compared to the traditional reinforced concrete, that is RC concrete without pre-stressing. That is RC means reinforced concrete without pre-stressing. The pre-stressing concrete has several advantages. A fully pre-stressed concrete member is usually subjected to compression throughout its lifetime. That is throughout its service life or the intent of this structure, it will be under compression. That is our primary target. That is the pre-stressed concrete will be completely in compression during its service life. We will not allow it to have any kind of tension. That is, if you are having a pre-stress or a normal beam like this, once we apply this pre-stressing force, that is in the form of compression, what happens is it will get deflected. It will deflected like this. It will be under compression. So even if we apply the force, what happens is if we apply the force like this, it will try to deflect in this way, which means again this will be in compression only. So it is throughout its service life, even if we apply load, it will be in compression only and there won't be any tension, which means the concrete is safe. Now the section, the main advantages here are the section remains uncracked under service loads, which means there isn't any tension which is going to happen, which means if no tension means what, there won't be any crack, isn't it? There is no tension means look, there won't be any crack because the concrete is very good in taking tension, and so there won't be any crack. So if there is no crack means what, the water or the external things won't percolate into the reinforcement, which means the reinforcement will not corrode. The reduction of steel corrosion, that is, I can say the pre-stressed concrete member, it has an increase in durability under aggressive and normal condition. The durability will be very much high because it will be an uncracked section. Now, improved resistance for shearing force due to the effect of compressive stresses. That is, you're having something like this. You're applying a force like this. This is your pre-stressed force, right? Now, if I am applying a load like this, due to this compressive force from either sides, this will be this section. If I am taking the shear force at this section, will be high. isn't it? Because due to this compressive force or pre-stressing force, the shear force at this section will be very much high. So a pre-stressed concrete member will have improved resistance to shearing forces due to the effect of this compressive force. Lighter and slender members due to the use of high strength concrete and steel can be used. In pre-stressed concrete member, we use high strength concrete and steel, and as a result of this, we can have very much small members. Lighter and slender means lighter in terms of weight, and slender members mean the dimensions will be very much small because we are using high strength concrete and steel. And we will discuss in detail why we are using this high strength concrete and steel in the upcoming lectures or in today's lectures itself. I told you this is having lighter and slender members. This is because large spans are possible with pre-stressing members. That is, we have seen the examples like when we require a large span bridge, we will go for this pre-stressing. When we require building with large columns, that is free spaces, we require a lot of free spaces, there we require large columns. But if we are providing very much large columns, then such things will not be, it will not serve its purpose. So at that time we require slender columns. Slender column means the dimensions will be very much small, but the height will be very much high. And when we require large cantilever spans, we'll go for, or when we require an auditorium where there should not be any obstruction in between, at least we should provide a large span beam, such times we'll go for this pre-stressing, mainly because for a normal pre-stress slab, we'll take an LBD ratio of 28. Last semester you have studied for a normal RCC slab, we'll consider an LBD ratio of 30 or 32 like that. So we'll consider an LBD ratio of 28, but for a pre-stress slab, we'll consider an LBD ratio up to 45. So you can imagine for a larger span, what will be the depth required? We'll require a smaller depth when compared to a normal RC slab. So when the depth is reduced, the weight reduces, and when the depth is reduced, which means it will be a slender member or a smaller member. Less deformation or improved serviceability. As I have told you, due to this, there won't be any much deflection because it is having a profile like this. So the deflection, it has to deflect, which means it has to form a shape like this. So it won't form a shape like this in its lifetime. So there will not be much deflection when compared to the normal RC structure. Improved performance or resilience under dynamic and fatigue load. That is, due to the dynamic or cyclic or loading, there will be more resistance. Higher moment of inertia. As it is having higher stiffness, it will be having higher moment of inertia. Suitable for uses in pressure vessels, liquid retaining structures, long span structures, etc. In pressure vessels, etc., there should not be any leakage or something. So we require an uncracked section, or if for a storage, liquid storage, retaining structures or water tanks, etc., we require an uncracked section, and there we can use this pre-stressed concrete a lot. Now we will discuss on the materials used for pre-stressing. As I have told you, the materials used for pre-stressing are high strength concrete and high strength steel. So we will focus mainly on this high strength concrete and high strength steel. First we will discuss on high strength concrete. The high strength concrete here is mainly used to bear large bearing stress developed at the ends near steel reinforcement in post tension members. As we have the post tension members like this, once the concrete is being casted, we have the duct here. Through this duct we will be placing the tendons, and at one side we will be anchoring it. Now we are applying the force from the other edge. So if the concrete is not having sufficient strength at this point, what will happen? Once I am applying this pull, this will get crushed here and the sufficient pull cannot be maintained. So in order to bear large bearing stress, we require a high strength concrete at this point as well as throughout this module. Okay, so the first thing is that. Second, to bear large bond stress developed in concrete in pre-tension members. The second one is the pre-tension members we have here like this. Now once the concrete is strengthened, then what will happen? I'll cut this tendons from here, and as a result large bone still is getting transferred to the concrete from the tendons like this, right? It is getting transferred like this. So if the concrete doesn't have sufficient strength to accommodate this bearing stress, what will happen? It will get tear, it will get crushed. So here also we require a large amount of bearing strength for this concrete. In order to have this, we will use high strength concrete. It reduces the loads due to creep and shrinkage. The creep means the deformation of the deformation produced due to sustained loading, and shrinkage is the deformation in concrete due to the expulsion of water. So this too can be reduced if we are using high strength concrete. There are the properties of the high strength concrete, and we will discuss this in detail when we are going for the loss of pre-stress members. So the creep and shrinkage, as you have studied in your concrete technology, if you are using high strength concrete, these two can be reduced, which are very good advantage for this pre-stress members. More resistance to concrete against shear. As you know, we have studied in the RCC also, when the strength of the concrete increases, your torsi value or torsi max value also increases, which means the shear strength also increases. Now more load or stress can be allowed. As the strength of the concrete is more, we can allow more load and more, or we can allow more stress. So these are the advantages why we are using, or the thing behind the use of high strength concrete in pre-stress members. And you can see here the minimum grade of concrete used. This is very important. The minimum grade of concrete, according to your IS specifications, the minimum grade of concrete used for pre-tension members is M40. So don't think of any grade of concrete less than M40 for pre-tension members. And the minimum grade of concrete used for post-tension members is M30. And this is a very important question considering your gate examination as well as for your interviews. So for minimum grade of concrete used for pre-tension is M40, and that for post-tension is M30. Now the pre-stressing steel. So first we will discuss on the different forms of this pre-stressing steel. That is, it can be wires. That is, a pre-stressing wire is a single unit made of steel. The nominal diameter of the wires are 2.5, 3 mm, 4 mm, 5 mm, 7 mm and 8 mm. That is, its very small diameter wires will be used for pre-stressing. That is, we will have a combination of normal RC and this pre-stressing wires, and this tension will be provided for this small wires. The wires used are either plain wire, that is equivalent to your MS bar, or it can be indented wire. There will be small indentation on the surface such that sufficient bond will be developed. So you can see here, this kind of wires will be used. And here you can see a group of wires are being used. This is called as a tension. We'll discuss this soon. This, you can see a small wire here. This is one wire, and you can see the diameter. It's very small. 2.5 mm diameter means it's very small. It's equivalent to the size of your pen. The diameter of your pen you are using, that much small it is. Okay. Now the strands. Strand means it is the advanced version of this wire. A few wires are spun together into a helical form to form a pre-stretching strand. You can see here, see in this picture, you can see here, this is one wire. This is being formed, spun in the form of a helical, and it is being used. This is called as a strand. And the next one is tendons, a group of strands. That is, the first one is wires, a group of wires is called as strands, and a group of strands or wires are placed together to form a pre-stressing tendon. The tendons are used in the post-tension members. You can see here, this is a tendon. You can see here, the group of wires are being used. This whole arrangement is called as a tendon. You can see here, this is called as a tendon. So the pre-stressing steel will be used either as wires or strands or as tendons. It depends on the type of the member being casted or being made. So you can see here, these are the normal reinforcing bars you have studied last semester, and this is the pre-stressing wires or bars. It's very small compared to this. You can see here, this is very small, thin wire. It's like it's having a diameter of your pen, like 2 mm, 3 mm, like that. It's very small. Now the high strength steel. As you know, if I am drawing the stress strain curve, stress here and strain, this is in Newton per mm square. So for mild steel, you have stress strain curve like this, and this is 250 Newton per mm square. And coming to HYSD bars, we have somewhat like this, somewhat higher, and we will consider the proof stress we have studied in the last semester. The proof stress 0.002 strain, and that is nearly 415 or 500 Newton per mm square. But when we are considering high pre-stress concrete, we are using high strength steel, and this is having a range which is very much high, and this is in the range of 1000 to 2000 Newton per mm square. So you can imagine how much high strength steel is being used. When the strength, in order to increase the strength of the steel, we'll have more carbon content. When the carbon content increases, the strength of the member also increases. So that's what we are using here. We are using very much high amount of steel in order to cast or make a pre-stress member. So you can imagine how much load can take. This, we are using this high strength steel mainly due to the reasons which I will tell you shortly. That is, the value of loss of stress due to various reasons is about 200 Newton per millimeter square to 300 Newton per millimeter square. That is, once we are applying this pre-stressing force, there will be loss due to many factors, and that loss at the end will be nearly 200 to 300. So suppose we are using 250 Newton per mm square, then there won't be anything left. If we are using 415 or 500 also, there won't be anything left. So in order to have enough strength even after this lossage, we need to have a high strength steel. The initial stress will not just be not should be such that the loss of stress is not greater than 10 to 20% of the initial stress. That is, we should apply a value such that the total loss should not be 10 to 20% than the initial value which is being applied. Due to this, we need to keep the initial stresses in the steel 1000 Newton per mm square to 2000 Newton per mm square. We will keep in between nearly 1500 to 1600 like that. That is, high stress in steel is kept so that sufficient pre-stressing force is still available even after pre-stressing. That is, even after this loss and all, there should be sufficient pre-stressing force such that there occurs the action of pre-stressing. Now, we will discuss on the different pre-stressing systems. And mind you, this you have to do it as an assignment. Briefly, I will explain what is mean by this pre-stressing system. A system of pre-stressing means the actual process adopted in making a pre-stress concrete. We have discussed that the post-tension and pre-tension. So how this is being adopted and different methods. It mainly involves the process of tensioning the tendons. So this pre-stressing system means mainly it involves the process of tensioning the member tendons. It can be different forms. How we will do the process of tensioning can be different. Okay, for pre-tensioning, post-tensioning, that is securing them firmly to the concrete, it can also be different. So based on that, there are different methods put forward by different people. You have to have a small writing on that. For pre-tensioning system, there is one method called as Hoyer system. Then Fresnel system, Gifford-Udall system, and Magnell-Blatten system. Some of the examples for post-tensioning system. So you have to read it carefully. I will give you the references for this. You can go through that. Make a small note. That will be your assignment number one. So different pre-tensioning and post-tensioning systems. Once you have understood clearly what do you mean by post-tensioning and pre-tensioning, this is very easy. So we will stop today's class with this. Hope you are clear with this. Thank you.